Hello, everybody. Everybody can hear me okay? Wow, what a nice library. Good-looking crowd. Let's see here. Oh, we'll go past. We'll go past that. So let me ask you a question. Have you ever driven down a country dirt road and come across an old farmhouse with an old dilapidated barn out back and wondered to yourself, who built this place? How many families celebrated Christmas here? Why is this abandoned? If you've asked those questions, then you are my people. My name is Ross Richardson. I am an author and a shipwreck hunter. I run a website, MichiganMysteries.com. Now, MichiganMysteries.com is dedicated to stories of missing persons, missing aircraft, and missing vessels in the Michigan region. I have a couple books out, The Search for the Westmoreland, which we'll talk about tonight, and Still Missing, we will talk about a story out of there later on in the program. Now, I live in L.A., probably not the L.A. you're thinking of. That's what we call our small town of Lake Ann. How many people here have been to Lake Ann? You guys don't call, oh, nice, nice, all right, good. Sometimes people don't know where that is. So we are up here and the pinky finger when we do the Michigan thing. A little bit about myself. I am a volunteer librarian at the Elmira Township Library in beautiful downtown Lake Ann. You could fit probably three of our libraries in this room alone. So it's there it is right there. It's very small. We don't have fancy computers here. We still stamp the books out. We're probably the last library in Michigan that is still stamping books and taking the cards and everything. So if you're visiting up in the Grand Traverse region, please stop by and visit us at the Elmira Township Library. I'm also the president of the Maritime Heritage Alliance based out of Traverse City. We are a nonprofit organization dedicated to preserving, interpreting, and sharing the history of our Great Lakes. And this is part of the way we do it. Another way we do it is this tall ship right here, the Madeline. She is a replica of an 1840s Great Lakes schooner. Total volunteer crew, built by volunteers and still managed by volunteers. We have a wood shop with master craftsmen and shipwrights. And if you don't know anything about woodworking, you don't know anything about sailing, come on in, we'll train you, we'll teach you. We have lots of people that love to share. And again, these wood boats, as you can imagine, take a lot of upkeep. So if you find yourself vacationing in the Grand Traverse region, please stop by and visit our campus on M22 across from the Discovery Pier. Now, my passion is Great Lakes shipwrecks. This is a photograph taken by a friend of mine. His name's down here, Cal Cothrati. Now, Cal is an artist and an underwater photographer. I'm going to use a lot of his artwork and underwater photography tonight because I'm terrible at that kind of stuff. I'm more into the shipwreck the research and the nerdies type stuff. But this is a pretty interesting image captured by Cal. This is ambient light in 160 feet of water. This is a steamer called the St. Albans over on the Wisconsin side of Lake Michigan. Now, if we look in the distance here, we can see a lot of ship. This is over 100-foot visibility in Lake Michigan. Now, when I was a kid, Lake Michigan was like pea soup. Green, you really couldn't see far. Now we're seeing 50 foot is pretty regular, over 100 foot we're seeing from time to time. Now, what causes that? Quagga mussels. You probably heard of zebra mussels. Quagga mussels now represent over 99% of the mussel species in the four lower Great Lakes. So zebras are basically gone. The quagga is a slightly larger, slightly more resilient cousin to the zebra mussel. It is an invasive species. And what these little critters do is they eat the plankton and the algae. Now, where zebra mussels would only go down 150, 200 feet and attach themselves to hard surfaces like shipwrecks, quaggas can now colonize on the bottom. As a matter of fact, the entire bottom of Lake Michigan, Lake Huron, Lake Erie, is a giant carpet of quagga mussels now. Scientists estimate there's over a quadrillion quagga mussels in Lake Erie, Lake Michigan, Lake Ontario, and the fourth one I didn't mention. Now, they're not in Lake Superior. If they are, they're very few. So very interesting. I think it's something to do with the alkalinity in the waters, just a little bit off, and they don't thrive in there. So these quagga mussels have really changed our environment in the Great Lakes. They've cleared up the water. We can now see the whole shipwreck. Sometimes you divers in here know, it's like you're diving in air. You can't even see the water, it's so clear. Here's another photograph by Cal. This is the Rouse Simmons. You probably know it better as the Christmas tree ship. And this is in about 160 feet of water on over on the Wisconsin side of Lake Michigan. And we see it's totally infested with quagga mussels. Couple divers here. Again, this is ambient light in 160 feet of water. And off to the side here, just a carpet of quagga mussels that now covers the bottom of the lakes. Now, the deepest found shipwreck in Lake Michigan is in about 500, 550 feet, and that's completely infested. We think these quaggas go all the way down to the bottom of Lake Michigan, 900 feet deep. Just we haven't found a shipwreck deep enough yet to verify that, but that will happen in the near future, I think. Let's talk about some shipwreck discoveries. So an article just came out today talking about the acceleration of shipwreck discoveries in the Great Lakes. In Lake Michigan alone, 13 shipwreck discoveries were announced last year. I can remember back about 10, 15 years ago when we were lucky to have one big announcement a year in the Great Lakes. So with improved technologies and affordable side scan sonar, improved research, everything's been modified. We're in the sweet spot right now where tons of shipwrecks are being discovered. So here's the last five shipwrecks that discoveries that have been announced. First is the SS Arlington. Now, it's my favorite kind of boat. It was built right here by the Detroit Shipbuilding Company and launched in 1913. She's 244 feet long and a bulk freighter. In spring of 1940, the SS Arlington was carrying a load of wheat and heading into a Lake Superior gale. The captain said, take it right down the middle of the lake. The first mate argued and said, let's hug the shoreline. Well, the captain won out and they went out into the middle of the lake and battled the storm, and the ship started to sink. The crew wanted to abandon ship. The captain said, no, no, stay put. They all got in a lifeboat and left the captain on the bridge waving goodbye, they said. I think he was waving for him to come back. Anyways, the captain went down with the ship on this one. That was spring of 1940. She was discovered by Great Lake shipwreck hunter Dan Fountain and the Great Lake Shipwreck Historical Society. She was found 35 miles offshore in 600 feet of water. Some newspaper articles here. Now, if we get back to some footage of the shipwreck, there is her route right there. Of course, she didn't make it. Yep, one of the newest shipwrecks of 1940. There's some great artwork by Robert McGreevy. And there's some underwater footage of ship's wheel. You can see no quagga mussels. So only on Superior wrecks now are we seeing no quagga mussels. The Trinidad discovery was announced. The Trinidad was built in Grand Island, New York in 1867. She was 138 feet in length and was a cargo ship running grain between Buffalo and Chicago and Milwaukee on May 11, 1881. While heading from Port Huron to Chicago, she ran into a heavy gale and sank in deep water. Here's some underwater imagery of the wreck site. This is a new technology called photogrammetry. And what this is thousands of pictures taken and fed into a supercomputer and a 3D model rendered of the wreck site. There's Brendan Balod and Bob Jake, the discoverers of the wreck. She was discovered in 270 feet of water over on the Wisconsin side of Lake Michigan. Two-masted schooner, again, pretty good sized. The entire crew was rescued, nine of them. However, the ship's mascot, a dog, went down with the ship. So again, great 3D model of the wreck site. And at 270 feet, that is obtainable for divers. That's a rebreather diver right there. And there's more of the 3D imagery brought to you by photogrammetry. So another good thing about the photogrammetry is we are able to see the states that the wrecks are in and monitor them over the years and over the decades and see how fast they deteriorate and the effects of other invasive species as they come along. Okay, over here in Lake Huron, the Africa Discovery was announced. Now, this is a Canadian boat built in Kingston, Ontario in 1873. She was 135 feet in length. She was a passenger steamer. You can see the passenger cabins right along here, the gangways down here for the cargo deck. Here's a great shot of her right here. Again, these passenger cabins, gangways for loading cargo, and that beautiful Victorian pilot house right there. So on October 7th, 1895, the Africa sailed into a storm in the Georgian Bay off of Cove Island Light and disappeared with all hands on board. She was discovered by a couple of documentary filmmakers filming a documentary about quagga mussels. Here's some great underwater footage. Again, windlass right there, completely infested with quagga mussels. A fish, it's rare to see a fish on a shipwreck unless it's a burbot, actually. That's a good shot. The Huron-10 went down in 1923. She collided with the steamer Cetus in fog and forest fire smoke in Lake Superior. That was October 10th, 1923. Now the Cetus was built in Lorain, Ohio and had a length of 238 feet. She was a steel steamer. She was found by the Great Lakes Shipwreck Historical Society this past summer. There's the collision damage right there. This is ROV footage. The shipwreck is in 800 feet of water. So excellent, very dark down there as you can imagine. Now, the story is the Cetus kept going full speed into the side of the Huron 10 because the captain knew if he backed out, water would rush in, it would sink even faster. So the crew of the Huron 10 jumped aboard the Cetus, but when they all got aboard, the first mate realized they left the ship's mascot, a bulldog, up in the forward cabins. He jumped back on the sinking ship, ran all the way to the front of the ship, rescued the dog, and jumped back aboard the Cetus. There's a drawing right there of Robert McGreevy showing the rescue. Again, amazing, no quagga mussels. Clean it up, a fresh coat of paint, she'd be as good as new. And finally, the Steinbrenner, the biggest and newest of the vessels which have been discovered. Built in Port Huron, Michigan. Again, I love these boats. Built in Michigan and they sank in Michigan waters. She was 427 feet long when she was launched in 1901. She is named after the great-grandfather of former New York Yankees owner George Steinbrenner. If you remember watching Seinfeld, George Costanza worked for George Steinbrenner. Being such a newer vessel, we have tons of great imagery of this ship. Again, typical Great Lakes freighter. Pilot house forward, engineering in the back, top loading hatches. Beautiful shots of her. So she went out into a storm in May of 1953 carrying iron ore and started taking on water. And eventually she went down. 14 survived, however, 17 died. You see the name on the stern here. Now this footage is amazing. This was found by Ken Merriman and Jerry Eliason. This is drop camera footage. If any of you have had experience with a drop camera, it's just a video camera on the end of a cable. This is 800 feet deep. And these guys are getting this great footage here. Pretty amazing. So usually these ships that are filled with iron ore hit the bottom pretty hard and bust up pretty good. So hopefully they'll get back out there with an ROV and there's some iron ore on the deck there. So hopefully they get an ROV and we can reconstruct this using photogrammetry and we get an idea of the entire wreck site. So pretty amazing discovery. Another one by Ken Merriman. He's probably been, him along with Dave Trotter, probably a couple of the most prolific shipwreck hunters that are out there today. Great shot, deck winch. Great discovery by those guys. I was involved in a shipwreck discovery, really more of a shipwreck identification recently. So a majority of shipwrecks being discovered right now are discovered with side scan sonar. The probably second most popular method is using Google Earth. A lot of people are finding the shoreline wrecks using Google Earth. And Google Earth has a feature where you can go back every 2 or 3 years in different imagery and it shows the waves different and the sand washes around. And it might be 7 years ago, you'll see a dark spot in the sand and guys will go out there and there will be a shipwreck. So a lot of people are using that to shipwreck hunt these days. This one was discovered by a Coast Guard pilot, Lieutenant Commander Matt Kuiper, retired, who was out on patrol in northern Lake Michigan in the Beaver Island archipelago. And they were flying over an island called High Island. And they looked down and Matt said, hey, that's a dark shape. That looks like a ship down there. So he told his rescue swimmer, hey, look at that. I think that's a shipwreck. The rescue swimmer was my next door neighbor. So what are the odds of that happening? This one jumped right in my lap. So High Island is up here. If you see South Manitou, North Manitou, this is Beaver Island, this big island right here. How many people here have been to Beaver Island? Okay, few folks. Nice, nice. Now Beaver Island is the exact opposite of Mackinac Island. They don't like tourists. Restaurants aren't good. But the islanders are wonderful people. So if you ever want to go to a place that's really different, Beaver Island is a magical island. Okay, there we go. St. James on Beaver Island is up here, and we're going to go to the outside of High Island. High Island here, home to the House of David, religious sect, back in the turn of the century. All right, let's take a look here. So I collected the information and we had an idea of what show, oh boy, we had an idea of what ship it was, but we needed to go out there and identify it. So I've got friends on Beaver Island. That's Mark Engelsma. He is a Happy Paddle kayak shop and bike rental on Beaver Island and fellow scuba diver. I'm gonna snorkel this one. So we're off of High Island right here. I got the coordinates from Matt and went out there. And this is some GoPro footage of what we found. This is from Mark right here. So immediately we knew these were some bottom planks from an old schooner. The wreck that we were researching was wrecked in 1869, built in 1854. So right then we knew, okay, it's a shipwreck. Was surprised at how rocky that bottom is. Rocks for quite a ways. So Mark said he found these boxes and he wasn't sure what they were, but I knew immediately what they were. We're coming up on one right now. This is a mast step. So that's on the keel of the vessel and you'll see a square notch in the top and the mast would actually have a square notched in the bottom to fit in there so it wouldn't spin when they built the ship. So we found two of these and the schooner we were looking for was a two-masted schooner. The measurements checked out everything, and we were able to identify this shipwreck. Again, these shallow water wrecks are beaten over a century by ice and wave action. So we call them board piles. They don't look like ships like we think of beautiful shipwrecks. They're kind of beat up, and this is what you have right here. The keel, everything above the keel is ground down by centuries of ice going over the top. So here I am snorkeling. So you don't always need super high-tech gear to research these shipwrecks. As a matter of fact, that's one of my favorite things in the summer to do is we know where a lot of shipwrecks are shallow water and we take the family out and just do a lot of snorkeling. So there it is, it's about 12 feet of water. And again, a very remote spot off High Island. And there's that mast step, gives you a little bit of perspective on the size of that. So we were able to take all this information and identify this ship as the Live Yankee, which wrecked in 1869. And the story is the captain got lost in a snowstorm in November of 1869 and ran right into the island. This was about midnight. Well, the waves broke over the stern all night long, and in the morning they got in the yawl boat. Now the captain had his 15-year-old niece on board, and they had a steward on board, and both of them were suffering from extreme hypothermia. So they got ashore. There were some indigenous folks with wigwams on shore who took the sailors in, as they often did, and heated them up by fire. They were able to save the captain's 15-year-old niece. However, the steward died, and he was a father of two out of Chicago, and he was buried immediately after on High Island. The crew dispersed, being picked up by other boats, and the captain stayed around for a week or two, salvaging what he could, selling what he could. Now, the Live Yankee was carrying wheat, and once the water got inside there, the wheat swelled and split the hull, and they just abandoned the hull there, and it laid there undiscovered. And had not Matt been flying over at that exact time and looked down and seen it, no one ever would have found this wreck. You know, we're going to skip this. There's a shipwreck announcement being made Saturday, I believe, and I think it's that shipwreck. Okay, so I'm going to talk a little bit about a shipwreck called the Westmoreland. I have some underwater footage of the very first dive on the shipwreck. It's kind of a fun story because there's some treasure and some whiskey weaved throughout this story. So I have a short little video I'm going to play for you that kind of tells the Westmoreland story. Let's take a look. On December 7, 1854, the 200-foot-long wooden passenger steamer Westmoreland foundered during a winter gale in Northern Lake, Michigan, taking 17 of her crew and passengers with her. 17 of her crew and passengers survived, however, and stories soon began circulating. The Westmoreland carried $10,000 in gold coins in her safe and 280 barrels of whiskey in her hold. Two decades after the Westmoreland foundered, her first mate, Paul Pelkey, returned to search for the ship and her treasures. In 1872 and 1874, newspaper articles claimed the Westmoreland was discovered and salvaged, her engine and boilers delivered to a dock in Chicago. In 1936, 25-year-old Max Knoll and 19-year-old Jack Brown teamed up with an old salt from Frankfort, Michigan by the name of Captain George Waters and launched a search expedition to find the treasure ship. Cap Waters, who actually met the Westmoreland's first mate, Paul Pelkey, during the 1870s, claimed to know the exact location of the Westmoreland. The trio was said to have found the wreck and then used prototype dive gear to dive and explore the wreck site, which they described as a broken-up board pile. The following year, 1937, Jack Brown and Max Knoll founded the Desco Corporation. Desco, the diving equipment and salvage company in Milwaukee, Wisconsin, went on to be one of the biggest diving equipment manufacturers in the world. The 1950s brought a couple more expeditions to find the Westmoreland. In 1954, Captain Harold E. Van Nieman of Flint, Michigan, searched for and claimed to have located the treasure shipwreck. He said the wreck covered and uncovered with the sand and also claimed to have recovered a barrel and had it sent out to have its contents analyzed. Sadly, the following year, 1955, Van Nieman was arrested on fraud charges brought by the investors of his Westmoreland expedition. In 1957, Jim and Nancy Sawtell arrived in Frankfort, Michigan and spent more than a decade looking for the Westmoreland. The Sawtells are best known for creating shipwreck restaurant interiors and shipwreck furniture, which was sold in the Leland and Charlevoix areas. The 1960s, 70s, 80s, and 90s brought around a dozen treasure hunting expeditions to northern Michigan. but no claims of finding the ship or her treasures. On July 7, 2010, while side-scanning the waters near Sleeping Bear Dune, I ran over a large, ship-shaped target in nearly 200 feet of water. 3 days later, I journeyed back to the site to dive the mysterious underwater object. It was just me and my brother Bob on the boat. My plan was to dive down to the object, and if it was the Westmoreland, film the hogging arches, which would positively identify the target as the Westmoreland. We hooked the object, I suited up, and down the line I went. I looked down, and below me I saw the bow of an enormous ship. I only had a brief moment to look, then I went back to the ritual of clearing my ears, inflating my dry suit, and aiming my camera. I slowly made my way aft, surveying the wreck, and pondering if I was the first one to see this in the last 150 years. The forward cabins and pilot house were missing, and I saw the mast broken off about 6 feet above the deck. It was the same diameter as your typical telephone pole. The arches came into view. They rose about 12 feet above the deck, the passenger railing perfectly intact. There was a brace connecting the arches, a round tube about 6 inches in diameter. I reached out a hand and touched it. As I passed by, it was covered in quagga mussels. The deck appeared to be collapsed between the arches. I continued towards the stern. I wanted to see if the engine and boiler were still there, or if she was salvaged in 1874, as a newspaper report said. In the distance, the lifeboat davits appeared, the cranes used to launch the lifeboats. And there was a smokestack base, the smokestack plenum with a boiler right below it, and the engine cylinder right behind that, covered with a piece of deck, and those davits that came about 14 feet off the deck. The ship wasn't salvaged. I decided to go to the very stern, and out of the gloom appeared the auxiliary helm, a perfectly intact 4-foot ship's wheel. A single word raced through my mind. Virgin. This was the Westmoreland, and she was a virgin wreck. Over the next 2 years, the Westmoreland revealed herself to us. Her legend, her history, and her wreck site. An underwater museum, an ice water time capsule. The Westmoreland has been lying on the bottom of Lake Michigan, unmolested, since 1854. The auxiliary helm, not a spoke or spindle out of place. It's almost a miracle considering the Westmoreland went nearly vertical when she sank. The passenger railing, still intact around most of the ship. Quagga mussels cover much of the vessel now, hiding details, but giving us the incredible visibility we have in the Great Lakes today. The lifeboat davits. Eyewitnesses say one of the davits hooked the last lifeboat launch, flipping it over, throwing 15 of its passenger and crew into the icy water. They all drowned right here on the stern of the Westmoreland. Looking down, we see the propeller and the rudder. Just the bottom blades of the four-bladed propeller touch the sand. The Westmoreland lies on a very hard bottom.
Looking at the stern, we see the rudder with its unusual two attachment points. With nearly 100-foot visibility, the Westmoreland reveals herself further. From the bottom of Lake Michigan to the top of the Hogging Arch is a remarkable 30 feet. The white oak construction of the Westmoreland has proven resilient, considering she spent over 15 decades in the bottom of Lake Michigan. A gangway is wide open, her hatch being blown off during the sinking, and we see the passenger deck collapse down onto the cargo deck. Eyewitnesses said passengers and crew members were clinging to the arches as the Westmoreland went down when she sank in that December storm in 1854. Cal Coltrati, a Milwaukee artist, created this beautiful image of the Westmoreland wreck site, showing us an opportunity to penetrate the bow area. With the bulwarks missing, it's easy to enter the Westmoreland, her portside anchor hanging down, woodstock aiming towards the bottom of Lake Michigan. A heavy coating of quagga mussels obscures the Westmoreland's oak timbers. The water temperature is 39 degrees as we enter a room that has been unseen by human eyes since over a decade before President Abraham Lincoln was assassinated. The windlass comes into view, covered in quagga mussels, chain still wrapped around it. Signs of the violent sinking are everywhere. Collapsed deck, pieces of wood laying all about. And there's a large cargo container, probably containing a cargo meant for the garrison at Mackinac Island. Behind that container, a staircase, still intact, rising up to the passenger deck. As we move towards the stern, we see a small opening to the yet unexplored bilge level.
We sometimes refer to shipwrecks as underwater haunted houses. They're spooky, mysterious, it's always cold down there, and usually the site of tragedy. But the Westmoreland is quite an intact shipwreck from that era. This is artwork done by Cal Coltrati that really demonstrates what the Westmoreland looks like today. About a year ago, the Westmoreland was in the news again, and the Daily Mail in the UK had an article about treasure hunters looking for gold and whiskey. Part of the story is true. I've been working with the fine folks at Mammoth Distilling, based in Michigan, and we have an idea. We want to salvage a piece of wood from the Westmoreland wreck site, not off the ship, but off to the side of the ship. We want to cut it into staves, toast it, and flavor a whiskey from it as a tribute to the stories of the 280 barrels of whiskey on this ship, and use the funds from that to further artifact preservation and shipwreck discovery in the Great Lakes. So the thing I love about the folks at Mammoth, we're all storytellers. We love telling a story. And not only will you be able to hear the story of the Westmoreland, you'll be able to taste the story of the Westmoreland, which I'm pretty excited about. So look forward to hearing more about this in the news coming up. The process is ongoing. On to Still Missing. So Still Missing is a book, and unfortunately I just sold out of it. It is available on Kindle, but it's a story of a missing person, a story of a missing ship and a story of a missing plane, some of the more intriguing stories that I found from my website and gone into a little more, bit more of a long form there. So I'd like to talk about missing aircraft in the Great Lakes. These are some crash sites in our lakes, mostly undiscovered. There's probably 1,000 missing aircraft in the Great Lakes. It's really unbelievable. And down here, there's almost 100 missing naval aircraft, and we'll talk about those in a second. World War II era fighters and bombers. Probably the most famous missing aircraft in Michigan is Northwest Airlines Flight 2501. It disappeared in June of 1950 with 58 passengers and crew on board. She was crossing Lake Michigan, somewhere between South Haven and Benton Harbor, heading towards Milwaukee, and flew into a summer storm and vanished. People have been looking for this plane for years. Hundreds of square miles have been searched trying to find this, and it's still sitting out there on the bottom of Lake Michigan somewhere. It's pretty amazing to think that that hasn't been found yet. And there's almost 100 missing naval fighters and bombers. Now, in World War II, to train naval aviators to take off and land on aircraft carriers, they didn't want to do it in the Pacific. It's way too dangerous. So we had a couple of aircraft carriers right here in the Great Lakes, the Wolverine and the Sable, and they were based out of Chicago. So many pilots were trained right here in the Great Lakes, and of course there were many accidents. Now we're seeing an aircraft being recovered here. A&T Recovery has found most of these and are recovering about one a year. They team up with a corporate sponsor and a place like the Air Zoo in Kalamazoo, and they'll work out a deal to totally restore these aircraft and get them back into great condition. I think it's a noble cause, especially since the quagga mussels produce a phosphate as a waste, which is eating the aluminum. So these aircraft are starting to deteriorate much more quickly now. As a matter of fact, in 10 or 20 years, there might not be much left of these aircraft. So we want to get as many as we can up. Some of them are rare. Some of them, there's only one or two examples left in the world. So we want to get those up. So a story I wrote about and still missing is a story of the Blocks Cessna. And this is John and Jean Block. They disappeared July 4th, 1977. Now, July 4th, 1977 was much like our last 4th of July. Beautiful summer day, maybe a little hazy. They had about 3 miles visibility. They were flying from Macomb County Airport to the Lost Creek Sky Ranch in Luzerne, Michigan. How many people here have been to Luzerne? Okay, it's up there. It's a very small town, very hilly, very wooded area. Well, they took off. It should have been a 2-hour flight, and they vanished. Their flight was totally overland, and they never made it. And no trace has ever been found of the Blocks and their Cessna. Now, we have a group of about 10 of us that are still looking for this aircraft using a variety of methods. So they took off here. We think what we know of John Block Sr. is he would have followed 75 up and either went north at West Branch or went over to Grayling and cut across 72 to find the Lost Creek Sky Ranch. Now his son, John Block Jr., is a friend of mine, and a couple years ago took an airplane ride over the Lost Creek Sky Ranch just to gather information. He said even now, it's still hard to see. It's just an airstrip cut out of the woods, very difficult to find. And I can imagine it was only worse back in 1977. So where could this plane be? We don't think it's down here. If we look at the population map, it's a lot of farmland in here along 75. But when you get up here, you have this dark green, less than one person per square mile. That's the Huron National Forest. Very remote stuff, very rugged terrain. Lots of cedar swamps, all types of areas for things to get lost and people not to find it. We think that if it was somewhere easily accessible, it would have been found by now. A few years back, we were approached by a gentleman who said he found something in a swamp using Google Earth, and he thought it might be part of the wing of the aircraft. So We got a group of us together on Thanksgiving weekend a few Thanksgivings ago and went to this swamp 7 miles south of the airstrip in Luzerne. And this swamp was maybe a mile and a half long and maybe a half mile across and almost impassable. But we had a couple guys put on waders and go out to that site and really look things over. As a matter of fact, this is Josh Block right here. That's the grandson of John and Jean Block. And that's how he spent his Thanksgiving weekend looking for his grandparents. So this family is still motivated to try to find out what happened. Now, we didn't find anything out there. However, a couple lights went off in our heads. Number one, there's some areas out there. Now, we found old tree stands around this huge swamp, but nothing was going through it. It was almost impassable by humans. So we think it's in an area like that that just nobody has seen. It's difficult to come by. So this guy found it using Google Earth. Can we use Google Earth to find missing aircraft? So this couple from Howell, Michigan took off from Drummond Island back in 1997. They were a couple of school teachers. They took off. It was a foggy day. They disappeared. Everybody thought they were somewhere in Lake Huron. In 2018, over 20 years later, a forestry worker just outside of St. Ignace by Castle Rock was going through, again, a very remote, very hilly, tough to navigate terrain. If you've been in the UP, you see how thick it gets off the highways there. And he came across their aircraft, and they were still sitting in it. Over 20 years later, just a few miles outside of town. Here's some imagery from the crash site. The plane is still there. So in our group of about 10 people working on the Block's plane, we have a couple of younger hiker guys that go out in the woods and look at things we find using Google Earth. They hiked out to this site and looked it over. It's still there. It's too expensive to remove, too difficult to remove, and nobody wants to pay for it. The couple was recovered and they were put to rest. So this is still there. They got the GPS numbers, went to Google Earth, and marked back again over the years. And in the fall time, when the leaves are down before the snow, you could see this aircraft. You could see it from Google Earth. But how would anybody know to look there, and how would anybody know what to look at? So we now have a large group of us looking at Google Earth around the Lost Creek Sky Ranch to see if we can find the plane. And it happened again with this aircraft that looks just like this. A gentleman took off from Sheboygan, Michigan, flying to Escanaba on December 1st, 1989, and ran into a snowstorm and had some problems. Anyways, he disappeared. Many people thought he was in Lake Michigan. In 2002, a couple bear hunters found his aircraft in the woods, in a cedar bog. They were outside of Curtis. If you know your UP, Engadine, Curtis area, very thick area. They were out there and they came across and he was still sitting in the aircraft. Here's some current pictures. The aircraft is still there. We got the GPS numbers and guess what? You can see it on Google Earth. So we're hoping by crowdsourcing some of these cases, and we have people analyzing Google Earth, and we find targets that look good, and we send our hikers out in the woods to look at them. And hopefully someday that will lead to discovery. We've also created a public service video. Yeah, more of that crash site. We've created this public service video right here to show what an aircraft can look like in the woods. Now, it doesn't look like an airplane anymore. As a matter of fact, you look, that looks like a car engine and some old mobile home parts, right? So we're hoping by sharing this with DNR workers, forestry workers, hikers, hunters, that hey, if you find wreckage in the woods in some remote place, please let us know. Please share this information because you could really solve a mystery. And again, it's not going to look like a plane. We know that, or it would have been found already. It probably hit pretty hard and looks pretty banged up. But the search is still ongoing. I think I'll skip You know what? We'll go, yeah, we'll talk a little bit about this. Seeking the Lord. So here's a shipwreck discovery I made a few years ago. Again, this is a Michigan boat which sank in Michigan waters. If you know the Sleeping Bear Dune National Lakeshore, this is just 1.8 miles off of Port Oneida. They almost made it to shore, but everybody survived on this one. This is the Jarvis Lord, built in Marine City, Michigan in 1872. She's 190 foot long wood freighter, a bulk freighter. So in 1885, she was going through the Manitou Passage and sprung a leak. It was August, nice summer day. The captain tried to run it on shore and he got close. They abandoned ship. The ship basically sank out from under the lifeboats as they launched them. Everybody survived. They had great location of where it was. Of course, it's nowhere near that. I looked for this thing for 8 years before I found it, and it was nowhere where it was supposed to be. So don't trust the newspaper. And here's a little news piece on the shipwreck, the Jarvis Lord.
There are many Great Lakes shipwrecks that are considered to be holy grails by hunters. We're on board with a group of explorers who believe they found one that sank in the 1800s.
Somewhere off Sleeping Bear Point, hidden within the uneven underwater topography that makes up the Manitou Passage.
The quickest route up to the Mackinac Straits was in between the islands.
Rests a wreck.
It's a smaller version of the Edmund Fitzgerald.
Its final resting place has been a Great Lakes mystery for more than a century.
People have looked for it before.
Ross Richardson is one of them. His side scan sonar captured this image.
I thought, okay, this could be that vessel.
Only one way to know for sure. Get back out there. Go to the bottom. Get eyes on it. With the shoreline behind, four footers in front.
We can do this.
This risky expedition begins.
I'm excited to see what it is. I mean, we've been looking at the pictures and talking about it for 6 months or longer.
After a 30-minute ride,
we are there. This is right underneath us.
The wait is almost over.
Deploy the grapple.
While the anchor drops.
We're gonna wanna let it all out.
Yeah, that's what I thought.
And hooks onto the wreck.
We'll swing around with our bow into it and there'll be enough slack. It'll cushion our ride a little bit.
Diver Steve Weimer gears up for his trip of more than 200 feet.
All right, y'all set? I need a mask.
Beneath the surface. He starts his slow descent to whatever awaits.
Oh, I see his bubble.
Topside.
A regalis with tales of what he saw down there.
Anticipation.
I think it's gonna be pretty cool. One of probably three different vessels, so we'll see. It's the one we think it is, or a surprise.
Almost an hour later, Steve pops up.
Okay.
And makes his way to the back of the boat.
Mass.
Our land all over is a big windlass on the bow. The starboard side's kind of intact, but the port side is kind of peeled away and leaning. There is a big boiler type thing. From what I could see, the stern is all collapsed and kind of buried, broken up.
Could you make out a cargo of any kind?
No, I don't, if there was, there wasn't. Like the deck was like collapsed. But there had to have been one, two, three, four hatches, big beams, big masts. There was one that was partially sticking up and was broke off.
Is there a break in the hull?
Back on land.
The bow itself is on a 45 degree angle. But
armed with maps, models, and Steve's memory.
It's got to be bigger than a 130 foot schooner.
It is definitely bigger than that.
Okay, so that narrows it down a lot.
Their debrief intensifies.
It's sounding more and more like the Lord, and it's just the back end impaled.
Leading to an identification, the wreck they thought it was.
The Jarvis Lord.
The Jarvis Lord was a 193 foot freighter that sprung a leak and sank in 1885. Luckily, all crew members survived.
That is the first time anybody's seen this since the 1800s.
Lake Michigan still has many unidentified shipwrecks sprawled across its sandy floor.
I would like to find as many as possible.
The Jarvis Lord is no longer one of them.
I've spent some time out there trying to find this.
Brent Ashcroft,
So one of the fun parts of shipwreck hunting is when you have a good mystery and you get to solve it. We had to put a few things together to positively identify this as the Jarvis Lord, but it's just one of those gems that was flying under the radar. Now, the wreck site, it was beat up a little bit. We know it broke up as it went down. It was carrying iron ore, so it was basically a floating brick. Those iron ore boats go down hard, really smash into the bottom. I've got one more shipwreck story to tell about something I stumbled across, and it took me over 6 months to identify it. But if the Jarvis Lord and the Live Yankee are on the end of shipwrecks that aren't in good condition, this one's probably on the other end. Let's take a look.
To go diving, it's believed there may be hundreds of undiscovered shipwrecks still off of our shores in Lake Michigan. And tonight, we can take one ship off the list of missing. Fox 6's Ben Handelman with a discovery that may be one of the most significant finds ever discovered in any Great Lake.
Trying to just find something.
For anyone who has cast a line in the Lake Michigan, the mystery of what lies below.
I do hope we get one.
Draws us close to the shore.
This particular story starts out with a family trip.
Ross Richardson.
My cousins were visiting from Georgia and they wanted to go to South Manitou Island.
Lives on the other side of the lake. He spent nearly all of the summer of 2018 looking not for fish.
And they were all excited. They were like, ooh, we get to see some shipwreck hunting, not realizing how really boring it is, you know, 10 hours looking at a computer screen. But I said, on the way out to the island, we'll put the fish in the water and we'll kind of look around.
Wouldn't you know it?
After about 5 minutes, we ran over a small target. It wasn't big, but I knew it was something worth looking at.
A blip on his screen worth returning to.
A week later, I stopped by the site again on the way out to the islands with different family members. And I ran the sonar and got a little more imagery, and something significant happened. Something was ringing on the sonar 90 feet off the bottom.
Ross called and...
Meanwhile, in Milwaukee...
said that he had an interesting target.
Steve Weimer...
I saw the radar images.
And Cal Kothrati were sent the find.
I thought, boy, it sure looks like a shipwreck. Sure looks like a schooner.
The veteran shipwreck hunters have been fooled before.
I don't know how many times we've gone, oh, there's a wreck, and you go down and it's a rock or, you know, some other shape that just looks like a shipwreck.
The only way to be sure.
Only a few divers in the entire Great Lakes could make this dive.
Find a man who can dive nearly 300 feet deep into the lake.
It's a dive, yeah. I'll go dive.
Weimer making the roughly 7 hour drive to determine what was below.
I stopped at right around 210, 215 feet ish, and I looked around, but I didn't see anything. I kept going, and probably at about 240, 250 feet, I could see the ship. And I'm right over the bow.
With his camera rolling,
I was like, okay, yeah, definitely ship.
Weimer could not believe his eyes.
I just kind of swam along the port side towards the stern, and from there I could see the cabin. So once I saw the cabin, that was where I was like, whoa.
Standing 90 feet upright, the ship's masts are perfectly intact from the wheel to the cabin planks. Even the hatches are all in place.
When I saw the lifeboat, because it's right off the stern of the ship, I was speechless. I just was like, wow, this is amazing. Just, I can't believe it.
From aboard their boat.
This is the most intact shipwreck I've ever seen. It's just beautiful.
The men sent images of their find back to Milwaukee.
Every picture I looked at that was sent to me in the text just kept showing me more and more intact. And I'm like, oh my goodness.
An incredible find with even bigger questions.
I'm a shipwreck nerd, so I study this. I mean, that's what I do. When I have a chance, I sit down, I go through old records. So I know about everything missing, and I knew there was nothing in the area that really matched this vessel. So I knew we had a real mystery.
There were hints, including a distinct shape in the front.
We had a vessel here that, you know, probably had Wisconsin roots. A lot of clipper bows were made in Wisconsin and Manitowoc and Milwaukee. So, okay, that's kind of a clue there.
He poured over so many thousands of documents, came up with a short list.
But of course, I started at A, and it took me to W, and I found one, and I was like, oh, son of a gun. And they had a picture of it.
The mystery ship is a mystery no more.
What's the vessel?
The W.C. Kimball.
It was built in 1888 in Manitowoc, Wisconsin. It was sold to parties a year later in Northport, Michigan. It was traveling from Manistee with a load of salt, had barrels of salt in the hold, and cedar shingles on the deck. And they were heading to Northport and Traverse City to deliver these.
The captain, first mate, a newly hired deckhand, and one passenger made four on board.
They were shorthanded on the crew, but this journey would only be 50 miles, so I'm sure they were thinking, oh, we can make this. This would be a piece of cake.
While they had a name, the men wondered, why is a perfectly intact wooden schooner sitting on the bottom of Lake Michigan? What happened to her crew?
A shipwreck, it's wrecked, it's broken.
This thing settled on the bottom like a feather.
This is not broken, it's perfect.
That tells us that it was more than likely encased in ice.
The team now believes they know what happened.
We surmise that a early spring gale can build a lot of sea ice on a boat. And that is heavy, and it makes it unseaworthy. And once it gets submerged, now it's starting to sink.
They probably lost the captain first, the head of the ship, and then the first mate after that. And then the other two guys were very inexperienced, so one by one they were washed aboard, leaving it a ghost ship. The lifeboat on the stern, that was, again, pretty haunting, because that's the first thing you're going to go to if your ship is sinking. I think it was frozen as a block of ice, you know. It probably had 2-3 feet worth of ice on it, and it just settled oh so gently. You know, maybe the salt cargo helped keep it a little bit buoyant. We just don't know.
For more than a century, the whereabouts of the W.C. Kimball have been a mystery.
It's been found, you know, so it's not just forgotten.
A discovery made nearly on accident.
Now, 130 years later, it's the absolute best preserved wreck we have.
We're also scanning the bottom for
a perfect catch,
other wreckage,
or a group of shipwreck hunters,
other clues,
who say the search for the next great find,
possibly human remains,
is already underway.
If you like good mysteries, this is the ultimate way of sleuthing through and actually solving mysteries. There's a purpose to what we do also, and that's sharing the history.
Ben Handelman, Fox 6 News.
Absolutely remarkable. The men credit the Marine Collection at the Milwaukee Public Library and the Wisconsin Marine Historical Society for helping in their research, which was clearly thorough. Do you want to learn more about shipwrecks in our area? It is fascinating. Just head to the link section at fox6now.com. Wow.
These are some stories of mysteries, stories of discovery, stories of histories. And just all around good Michigan stories. Again, we live in a wonderful state where we have all these things right at our fingertips. I do have a book for sale tonight. The Westmoreland book is $19.99. Further details the stories of the shipwreck discovery of the Westmoreland. I am self-funded. Everything I do, I fund through talks like this and sales of books. So please come up and take a look. And thank you so much for coming out and hearing some Michigan mysteries tonight. Thank you.